हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, इन द प्रीवियस लेक्चर आई हैव डिस्कस्ड द वेरियस मेजरमेंट्स इंस्ट्रूमेंट्स यूज एट माइक्रोवेव फ्रिक्वेंसीज फॉर द मेजरमेंट ऑफ पावर फ्रिक्वेंसी इम्पीडेंस VSWR एक्सेट्रा. ऑल्सो वी हैव डिस्कस्ड द जनरल सेटअप ऑफ माइक्रोवेव टेस्ट बेंच एंड ब्रीफली डिस्क्राइब द ईच एंड एवरी कंपोनेंट ऑफ द माइक्रोवेव बेंच. नाउ इन द सेकेंड पार्ट ऑफ आवर लेक्चर वी आर गोइंग टू सी वेरियस टेक्निक्स टू यूज सम पैरामीटर्स सच एज पावर इम्पीडेंस VSWR फ्रिक्वेंसी एक्सेट्रा. Now, first of all, we are going to see the techniques used for measurement of power at microwave frequencies. Now, the various techniques include bolometric technique, calorimetric technique, and calorimetric watt meter technique. Now, depending upon the magnitude of the power, we can have these three different techniques. As we see, for low power measurement, low power here, the range, approximate range is 0.101 milliwatt to 10 milliwatt. If our power is in this particular range, then we are going to use bolometric technique to measure the power. Next, the medium range of the power. Medium range means here 10 milliwatt to 10 watt. If our power is roughly in between these limits, then we are going to use calorimetric technique to measure the power. And the last technique is the high power measurement technique. Here high power means greater than 10 watt power, and the technique for this high power measurement is calorimetric watt power technique. Now, let us consider these techniques one by one. So, the first technique here is low power measurement. As we know, low power means here 0.01 milliwatt to 10 milliwatt power. So, they are normally measured with the help of bolometers or the thermocouples. Now, these bolometers or thermocouples, their resistance changes with temperature. Depending upon the temperature, their resistance will decrease. Now, bolometers are further maybe of two types: barometers or the thermistors. Now, barometers, they are having positive temperature coefficient. The positive temperature coefficient here means the resistance of these type of devices will increase as we increase the temperature. So, because of this, the resistance is directly proportional with temperature. So, we are saying these are positive temperature coefficient. As temperature increases, resistance will increase. Another category is thermistors. Now, they are negative temperature coefficient. Here, the resistance is in inverse proportion with the temperature. As temperature increases, resistance decreases, and if temperature decreases, resistance will increase. This is how these thermistors work. And because of this inverse relation between resistance and temperature, we say these devices as negative temperature coefficient devices. Such bolometers use diode, where diode is a square device and it provides a current proportional to the applied power. And because this is a square device, so this applied power, that is the square of the applied voltage. As we know, the relation between power and voltage, that is why applied voltage, the square of the applied voltage. Now this figure shows how we can use this polarimeter to measure the low microwave power. Now here this is a rectangle waveguide. From this side we are applying our microwave power which we are going to measure, and in this waveguide we have connected a bolometer whose initial resistance is R1 ohm. That is, before applying any microwave power, the resistance of this bolometer is R1 ohm. And now we start applying our power from this side. Now when we apply power, the resistance of this will change. Let us say the resistance of this bolometer now becomes R2, that is after applying the power. So there is a change in resistance. From initially it was R1, now after applying power it becomes R2. So the change in resistance is proportional to the microwave power which can be measured using a bridge. So there is a change because we have applied power, so the temperature rises and the resistance will decrease. So this difference in resistance is proportional to the power we are applying, and that can be measured with the help of this bridge circuit. This is balance bolometer bridge. Here we can see this is a bridge formed by four resistances R1, R2, R3 and R4. There are another resistances R5, R7, R6. There is a milliammeter also to measure the amount of current flowing, and there is a source, that is DC source, and it is variable DC source. Now initially this bridge is balanced by adjusting this resistance R5, which varies the DC power applied to the bridge, and the bolometer element is brought to a predetermined operating resistance before microwave power is applied. And let us assume the voltage across this battery is E1 at balance. The microwave power is now applied and this power gets dissipated in the bolometer. The bolometer heats up and its resistance changes. Therefore, the bridge becomes unbalanced. This bridge becomes unbalanced. The applied DC power is changed to E2. From here, it changed to E2 to get back the balance, and this change in DC battery voltage, that is, initially it was E1, now after again rebalancing this, the voltage here becomes E2. So the difference E1 minus E2 will be proportional to the microwave power. Alternatively, the detector G here, this detector can directly be calibrated in term of microwave power, so that when the bridge is unbalanced, the detector reads the microwave power directly. This power is directly read by this meter. Now here these two resistances R6 and R7, these are for temperature compensation. R6, this R6 is identical and close to this resistance R3. If temperature changes and the value of this R3 reduces, this will not be interpreted as microwave power change because R6 will equally reduce. Thus, more current will flow through it and hence lesser amount will flow through bridge. That is, current through this R3 will be lowered, so will its temperature, thus restoring the balancing of this bridge. This is how this balance bridge with the help of this polarimeter going to calculate the low power within the range of 0.01 milliwatt to 10 milliwatt. Now let us discuss the second technique, that is calorimetric technique for the measurement of medium powers ranging between 10 milliwatt to 10 watt. Now the basic principle for power measurement in medium range can be understood by this figure. Here we are having a load, here we are having a input side where we are going to monitor the temperature of the input, and at the output side we are again going to monitor the temperature, and here we are going to apply the power. Now the principle will be the temperature rise of a special load is monitored, which is proportional to the power responsible for the rise. So if there is some rise in temperature at the output side, then that rise in temperature is only because of this microwave power. So special load must be necessarily have high specific heat. Example, we can have water. So knowing mass, specific heat, temperature rise at a fixed and known rate of fluid flow, power can be easily calculated. Also with rate of temperature rise we can know the power. Now the setup for measurement of medium power is like this. This is self-balancing bridge technique to measure the medium power. Here we are having the input load and the input load resistance. This input load resistance senses the input microwave power and heat generated in input load resistor raises the temperature of the gauge, raises the temperature of this gauge. This results in unbalancing of the bridge. This bridge unbalances. Signal due to imbalance is amplified and applied to the comparison load resistance. There is comparison load resistance. Here we are going to apply the signal due to imbalance. It is amplified and this is after amplification, this is applied to the comparison load resistance here. Now heat generated in comparison load resistance is transferred to its gauge and bridges rebalance. This bridges again rebalance. Now meter measures the amount of power that is supplied to the comparison load. This comparison load, this meter is going to read this. In order to rebalance the bridge, now the meter can be calibrated directly in term of the input power. This meter can be directly calibrated in term of its input power. Characteristics of two gauges be matched and also heat transfer characteristics from each load be same. Also to maintain constant temperature, the streams are passed through heat exchanger. There are heat exchanger. So टू मेंटेन कॉन्स्टेंट टेम्परेचर द स्टीम्स आर पास थ्रू हीट एक्सचेंजर जस्ट बी बिफोर दे कैन एंटर देयर रिस्पेक्टिव हेड. दीज आर द हीट एक्सचेंजर, दीज आर द रिस्पेक्टिव हेड्स. फॉर क्विक बैलेंसिंग कंपोनेंट्स आर इमर्स इन ऑयल स्ट्रीम्स. सो इन दिस फैशन वी कैन मेजर द मीडियम पावर बाय दिस सेल्फ बैलेंसिंग ब्रिज टेक्निक. नाउ लेट अस डिस्कस द थर्ड टेक्निक ऑफ पावर मेजरमेंट एंड दैट इज फॉर द हाई पावर मेजरमेंट्स. Now, as you know, high power measurements, the range is 10 watt to 50 kilowatt. Now, this calorimetric wattmeter method can be further subdivided into two types, that is dry type technique or the flow type technique. In dry type technique, it consists of coaxial cable fitted by a dielectric with high hysteresis loss, whereas in flow type calorimetric wattmeter method, it uses circulating water, oil, etc., which is a good absorber of the microwave energy. So, dry and the flow type depending upon this is for having a coaxial cable. Here, it is having a absorbing liquid. It may be water or it may be a oil. Now, fluid after flowing through a load experiences temperature rise due to the microwave energy. Now this rise in temperature or decrease in temperature, here only we will see there will be a rise in temperature because the microwave power will definitely increase the temperature of the output. So if we assume T1 is the temperature before the entering to the load and T2 is the temperature after it emerges out. So we can easily calculate these two temperatures, the output temperature, the outlet temperature and the input temperature. Now we can also have the difference between these two, the difference T2 minus T1. Now if we know these the difference of these two, we can directly calculate the power by this particular formula, which says the power will be equal to RK rho into the temperature difference divided by 4.18, where this P is the power we are going to calculate the microwave power in watt. This R, capital R, is rate of flow, the rate at which the oil or water is flowing in centimeter cube per second. K is the specific heat. This rho is specific gravity. And this is temperature difference in Celsius. Now, by this formula, we can easily calculate the high power. Now, heat loss is due to the conduction radiation. This is one of the disadvantageous feature of this, that there are losses due to the conduction and the radiation. Also, difference between temperature T1 and T2 is a measure of the power which has been observed. So, this is the basic principle on which this measurement technique is based upon. That is the difference between these two, output temperature T2 and the input temperature T1. By measuring the difference, we can measure the power which has been absorbed. So this is how we can measure the high power. So far we have discussed three different techniques for the measurement of three different powers. That is, for the low power measurement we are having bolometer technique, for medium power measurement we are having calorimetric technique, for high power measurement we are having K कैलोरीमेट्रिक वाट मीटर टेक्निक. नाउ वी आर गोइंग टू सी द वेरियस टेक्निक्स यूज फॉर द मेजरमेंट ऑफ फ्रीक्वेंसी. दीज टेक्निक्स मे बी वेव मीटर मेथड, अनदर मे बी स्लोटेड लाइन मेथड, और इट मे बी डाउन कन्वर्जन मेथड. सो लेट अस स्टार्ट आवर डिस्कशन ऑफ फ्रीक्वेंसी मेजरमेंट विद द हेल्प ऑफ वेव मीटर. नाउ दिस इज वेव मीटर. हेयर ए वेव मीटर इज टिपिकली कंस्ट्रक्टेड ऑफ अ सिलेंड्रिकल कैविटी रेजोनेटर विद अ वेरिएबल शॉर्ट सर्किट टर्मिनेशन. द शॉर्टिंग प्लंगर, दिस इज द शॉर्टिंग प्लंगर, इज यूज टू चेंज द रेजोनेंट फ्रीक्वेंसी ऑफ द कैविटी बाय चेंजिंग द कैविटी लेंथ. दिस लेंथ द वेव मीटर एक्सिस इज सो प्लेस्ड दैट इट इज परपेंडिकुलर टू द बोर्ड वॉल ऑफ द वेव गाइड. एज यू कैन सी हेयर, दिस इज द ब्रोडल वॉल एंड हेयर द वेव मीटर एक्सिस इज प्लेस्ड. नाउ द डोमिनेंट मोड TM011 is normally used in a wave meter. The most suitable mode, however, is TE011 because of its higher Q and absence of axial current. The TM010 mode is excited in the cavity through the coupling hole by a magnetic coupling. Any possible oscillation due to the plunger can be avoided by placing a block of polytron, which is an absorbing material, at the back of the tuning plunger. The various plunger position result in different cavity resonant frequencies. This tuning can be calibrated in term of frequency by use of known frequency inputs and observing a dip. This dip in the power meter. The power meter can be connected at the outside of the waveguide. Now, the absorption cavity characteristics are shown in this graph. Here, we are having the output power, and this is the frequency axis. Now, a resonant cavity wave meter is the microwave analog to tuned resonant circuit. Now basically there are two types of cavities. Those cavities may be of transmission type cavity or it may be absorption type cavity. Now when we are dealing with the transmission cavities, then they are going to pass the signals or the frequency to which they are tuned to. So that is why we are saying these as a transmission, because they are going to transmit. Now absorption type cavity, they are going to attenuate the signal to which they are tuned. So here in our wave meter we are going to see the absorption type cavities. From these absorption type cavities, almost 99.9% can be the accuracy can be achieved. The resonant frequency of the cavity wave meter is determined primarily by the physical dimension A, B and D. This is A, B and this D, and the mode is determined by M and P. This M and P, and this is the formula for the resonating frequency we can get. So when we see there is a dip like this, then at that point of time we can directly read the reading of the frequency from the frequency meter. When we observe the dip, then we see on our wave meter these there are two horizontal red lines and this is a vertical red line. Now at dip we stop rotating the plunger and we see the reading directly where this vertical line is matching with the these two horizontal line. So suppose in this case here this will be the frequency of the oscillations which are generated by the microwave source. So this is how we are going to calculate the frequency by wave meter technique. Now the second method of frequency measurement is with the help of a slotted section or the slotted line method. Now in this, when we use the slotted section, we are going to measure the two minima position, two successive minima position. Now at the distance, that is d minimum, between two successive minima of a voltage standing wave pattern in a short circuit line is lambda g by 2. So this lambda g by 2 will be equals to d minimum, and the frequency can be determined from the relation of this guided wavelength lambda g equals to lambda naught over 1 minus lambda naught over lambda c whole square and under the root. Now here, because we are using a rectangular waveguide, and for that rectangular waveguide the dominant mode is TE10 mode, and for that particular mode the value of cutoff wavelength is twice of A. So here instead of writing lambda C, I have directly written twice of A. So the formula for the lambda G becomes lambda naught over 1 minus bracket starts lambda naught over twice of A this square and whole equation under the root. Now for instead of using a waveguide we are using a coaxial line, then this lambda g will be equals to lambda naught over this under root of epsilon r. And by measuring the d minimum by the slotted line probe carriage, now in this lambda g is directly given by 2 and d minima that we have calculated from the slotted section, d minimum the distance between two minima. So this will give you the value of lambda g. Lambda c is given by twice of a, where a is a fixed dimension, that is the broader dimension of the rectangular waveguide. So these two values are known. From these two values we can easily calculate the value of lambda naught. Then the frequency can be calculated by C divided by this lambda naught. So that will give you the frequency with the help of this slotted line method. As we know, frequency is nothing but it is C divided by the lambda naught. So if we know the lambda naught, we can calculate the frequency. So this is how we are going to calculate the frequency with the help of this slotted line section. Now another method for frequency calculation is down conversion method. Now this is the block diagram of heterodyne based. Heterodyne means, hetero means we are going to use two different frequencies, and dyne mean mix. So this is the block diagram of heterodyne based down conversion technique used for the microwave frequency calculation. Most accurate method of microwave frequency measurement is this down conversion method. The most of modern automatic frequency counter uses this down conversion method to measure the frequencies above 500 megahertz. So as we can see in this block diagram, there is a mixer here is used in the design which beats incoming unknown frequency to be measured with known local oscillator frequency. The local oscillator signal is chosen such that the difference frequency falls within 500 megahertz bandwidth of the counter. Now this is the time base generator which is going to generate the first FIN frequency, the frequency which is going to be mixed here from this side. This will be within the frequency generated by this will be within 100 to 500 megahertz range. Now this FIN frequency is fed to the harmonic generator which generates a comb line of frequencies. From this harmonic generator we are generating a comb line of frequencies. These frequencies are spaced at FIN which extend up to the complete range of frequency counter. Now along with this, some suitable processor is also incorporated in the design to facilitate high performance measuring using advanced DSP algorithm. Now this microwave filter select one line of comb, say this KF in, which is fed to the mixer. Now this mixer is going to generate F X plus minus of this KF in. So this is the output which we get from the mixer. Now this frequency is amplified and is provided to the counter. The display contain, this display contain sum of video frequency and this K into F in frequencies. Here appropriate K into F in is generated by the processor. Signal detector block determines correct value of K. Here processor starts with K equals to 1 and will step through different K values across comb line until detector determines K where video frequency is available. At this point acquisition process is stopped and measurement can start. Now here there will be an automatic gain control unit which is used to desensitizes the video amplifier such that only strong frequency components of video signal will enter the Schmitt trigger, this trigger, and will be counted and measured accurately. So this is how this down conversion method technique is going to help in calculation of the frequency. Now let us see how VSWR can be measured. Now as we know, in any microwave practical application, any kind of impedance mismatches leads to the formation of standing waves, and the strength of these standing waves is measured by voltage standing wave ratio or VSWR. The ratio of maximum to minimum voltage gives the VSWR, which is denoted by S. Here these are the signals which are traveling in a slotted section and with the detector probe, we are going to see the V minimum value. We are going to calculate the V minimum value and V maximum value. Now the ratio of this V max and this is the V minimum. This ratio is nothing but this is the standing wave ratio. This is also equals to 1 plus rho over 1 minus rho, where rho is the reflection coefficient, and which is nothing but this rho is reflected power to the incident power ratio. So we can say our standing wave ratio will be equals to 1 plus rho over 1 minus rho. So from here we can say the value of S varies from 1 to infinity, and the value of this reflection coefficient, this is going to vary from 0 to infinity. Hence we can say the minimum value of our SWR or VSWR is 1. Now the measurement of VSWR can be done in two ways. One is for load SWR, that is where value of our standing wave ratio is less than 10, and another is high VSWR measurements. Now let us see how we can measure low standing wave ratio. Now the block diagram is shown here. This is the micro source, the pad, the slotted line, the respective load, and here slotted line is going to the output of this is going to the crystal detector, and from the detector it is going to the DC milli voltmeter. Now the value can also be read directly on a VSWR meter, as we have already discussed that there are three different scales on any VSWR meter. It can be the normal meter, it may be the extended, or it may be the dB scale. So VSWR can also be read directly on the VSWR meter, but there is another method with the help of a slotted section. In a slotted section, the probe of that slotted line is moved to get the maximum reading on the meter, here in this meter. So corresponding to that maximum reading, we denote it by Vmax. The attenuation is now adjusted to get full scale reading. This full scale reading is noted down. Now we can note this full scale reading. Now the probe of slotted line is moved to get the another reading, that is corresponding to the minimum value, and that is written as V minimum. Now the ratio of these two readings, V max over V minimum, is our desired standing wave ratio. Now here the meter can be calibrated in term of VSWR. Directly we can meter can be calibrated in term of VSWR, and the probe carriage is moved to give maximum deflection on the VSWR meter by adjusting the pad. This full scale deflection corresponding to VSWR of 1. So this is one of the simplest method to measure the standing wave ratio, but the value less than 10 can only be measured by this particular technique. Now the technique for measurement of high SWR is shown here. The measurement of high SWR whose value is greater than 10 can be measured by a method called double minima method. Now in this method, in a slotted section, the probe is inserted to get the minimum reading. This is the reading which is having the minimum value. Now, from this minimum value, the probe is then moved to a point where the power is twice the minimum. Let it be D1. If we move from this minimum toward this side, then at this particular point, this point, the power is double the minimum power. So this is one minimum power point, and the distance here is D1. Now probe is then moved to twice the power point on the other side of the minima, and that point is D2 at this point. So in this we are having these two points having the voltage Vx, and the distance is D1 and D2. Now, as we can see from this graph, P minimum is directly proportional to V minimum square. As we know, power is in direct proportion with square of the voltage. So here this was our minimum value. So the P minimum is directly proportional to square of this power. Now at this point we have taken, at this point and at this point, we are having power which is double the power minimum power, double the minimum power at this point and this point also. And the voltage corresponding to this is Vx. This is Vx, and this Vx is can be written as under root 2 of V minimum. From where this value has come, this can be understood by this. As we know, P minimum is in direct proportion to square of this voltage, minimum voltage. Now if in the our diagram, this is the twice of minimum power, and corresponding to this the voltage value is Vx. So this twice of minimum is also directly proportional to this Vx square. Now if we take the ratio of both the side, P minimum divided by this twice of P minimum, then we will get half equals to this V square this value divided by this value. So from here we get this 1 by 2 will be equals to V minimum square over Vx square. Now from this, if we cross multiply this, we will get Vx square equals to twice of V minimum square, and from here we can get Vx equals to under root 2 multiply by the minimum voltage V minimum. And as we know, for TE10 mode, because this is the dominant mode which is going to propagate inside a rectangular waveguide, and for dominant mode the value of this cutoff frequency, cutoff wavelength is twice of A, where this A is again the broader dimension of our rectangular waveguide. So and the value of this A is fixed. For suppose say for X band it is fixed. So we can easily calculate the this cutoff wavelength. Now lambda naught is C by F, and also lambda G is lambda naught over under root 1 minus bracket start lambda naught by lambda C bracket close square. So if we know this lambda G, we know at what frequency we are working, we know the value of lambda C, then we can easily calculate VSWR by this formula, lambda G divided by pi into D2 minus D1, where D2 minus D1 is nothing but this distance D2 minus D1. So if we know this D2 point and this D1 point, वी कैन पुट द वैल्यू ऑफ दीज टू इन टू दिस, वी कैन कैलकुलेट द वैल्यू ऑफ लेमडा जी फ्रॉम दिस फार्मूला, एंड वी कैन ईजिली कैलकुलेट द वैल्यू ऑफ वी एस डब्ल्यू आर. दिस इज हाउ वी आर गोइंग टू कैलकुलेट द वोल्टेज स्टैंडिंग वेव रेशियो विद द हेल्प ऑफ डबल मिनिमा मेथड. नाउ लेट अस सी सम टेक्निक्स टू मेजर द इम्पीडेंस. नाउ बेसिकली देर आर थ्री डिफरेंट टेक्निक्स यूजिंग अ मैजिक टी विच वी हैव ऑलरेडी स्टडीड इन आवर माइक्रोवेव कंपोनेंट्स दैट हाउ ए मैजिक टी कैन बी यूज फॉर द कैलकुलेशन ऑफ एन अननोन इम्पीडेंस. सेकेंड मेथड इज यूजिंग द रिफ्लेक्टोमीटर एंड थर्ड वन इज यूजिंग द स्लोटेड लाइन सेक्शन. सो हेयर वी आर गोइंग टू अंडरस्टैंड दीज टू टेक्निक, रिफ्लेक्टोमीटर टेक्निक एंड द स्लोटेड लाइन टेक्निक. एज मैजिक टी टेक्निक आई हैव ऑलरेडी डिस्कस इन द मैजिक टी एप्लीकेशंस. सो लेट अस स्टार्ट फ्रॉम रिफ्लेक्टोमीटर टेक्निक. नाउ द ब्लॉक डायग्राम फॉर दिस टेक्निक इज शोन हेयर. देर इज अ माइक्रोवेव सोर्स, देन द पैड, देन ए फॉरवर्ड डायरेक्शनल कपलर ऑफ 20 dB, एंड देन देर इज अनदर डायरेक्शनल कपलर बट इट्स डायरेक्शन इज रिवर्स, एंड देन द लोड. द सिग्नल कैन गो फ्रॉम डायरेक्शनल कपलर टू द लोड एंड ऑल्सो सिग्नल इज गोइंग फ्रॉम लोड टू directional coupler if there are some mismatch. Now here we see there is a forward inductor for this forward directional coupler and there is a reverse inductor for this reverse directional coupler, and the two signals are going to the reflectometer. Now this reflectometer will directly give you the value of this reflection coefficient rho, which is nothing but the under root of reflected power divided by the incident power, which can be written as like this: under root PR, that is reflected power divided by 100, and in denominator incident power divided by 100. So this will give you the directly the value of reflection coefficient. Now here the reflectometer indicates only the magnitude of the impedance, not the phase, but the slotted line gives both magnitude and phase of the impedance. So in this technique the two directional coupler are used to sample the incident power, that is incident power PI and reflected power from the load, that we can see from here. Now both directional couplers are identical except their direction. If I say the direction is reverse, here this is in forward direction, this is in reverse direction, only this is the difference. Otherwise both the directional coupler are same. Now as we know, reflectometer will give you directly the reading of this rho, which is the ratio of PR by PI under the root. Now if we know the value of this rho, we can know the SWR, VSWR by this formula. If we know the rho, we can calculate this S, because S is given by 1 plus rho divided by 1 minus rho. And if we know the value of this S and rho, then we can calculate the unknown impedance, that is Z, by this formula, where Z is, this Z is the unknown impedance and this ZG is the known wave impedance. So if we know the value of this rho, we can calculate the value of this Z. So rho is given by Z minus ZG divided by Z plus ZG. So this, if we know rho, we can easily calculate the value of this unknown impedance. Now here, because of directional property of the coupler, there will be no interference between forward and the reverse wave. Here there will be no interference, and input power is kept to a low level by means of a pad. So the input power should not exceed, so we can limit that input power with the help of this pad. And this is how this reflectometer is going to help in calculation of our unknown impedance. Now the next technique is using the slotted line. Now here there are two different setups we are going to use for the calculation of a impedance. Here as we see, this is the first setup where we are having a microwave source, the pad, the slotted line, the unknown load or the load whose impedance we want to calculate. Now the slotted line output is given to the detector, crystal detector, and this is going to the power meter. Now for this setup, the output will be like this. We are going to see the V max position and V minimum position. Once we note down these two position, this is the need for the need of this first setup. Now once we have calculated these two position, V max and V minimum, now we are going to change our setup a little bit. The change will only be in this unknown load. In second setup, sorted termination instead of unknown load block is used. So instead of this unknown load, if we are going to use a sorted termination here. So this is the output for the second setup. Now in this second setup, we see incident and reflected waves will be proportional to the mismatch of the load under test, resulting in standing wave that we have seen here. Now using slotted waveguide and with load ZL in the circuit 1, position of V max and V minimum can be determined, which I have already told ki we have to calculate the position of V max and V minimum with setup 1. Now replace the unknown load by short circuit and shift in minimum is measured. Now we are going to see where this minimum is shifted. This position is shifted. Now if minimum is shifted to the left, as shown in this figure, this minima is shifted left, then we can say there is a inductive impedance. And if the minimum position is shifted right, as shown here the minimum position, which was actually at this position, has shifted towards right, in that case we can say the impedance is capacitive in nature. So unknown impedance can be obtained by usual method of data recorded and a Smith chart. Now here in case of slotted line section method, both the reflection coefficient and impedance can be obtained in magnitude and phase, which was not in case of reflectometer. So students, this is all for today's lecture, in which we have studied some of the measurement technique for power, frequency, voltage standing wave ratio and the impedance. Thanks for listening my lecture. Have a very nice day.